There isn't a place for it on the agenda, by the way, but I suppose we should take apologies if we've got any apologies.
Councillor Jim.
Joe Wood, I haven't heard, had any apologies from Andrew or Mike Sullivan, so we can just make the assumption that they're on their way. Don't realise it's started 6 o'clock, not 6 o'clock. But we'll make a start. Next item I've got is appointment of vice chair. Are there any nominations, vice chair? Any nomination?
I'll propose Karl.
Karl, any other nominations? In that case, Karl, congratulations. You are. Oh, sorry, was there a second? I thought it was you. Yeah. Couldn't find any support because everyone had no chairs there. So congratulations, Carl. We like them both to come up together. Things and choice.
People are missing again.
Well, you might have applied to you, which is down the pole. Okay, so the next item we've got here. Talking of which, minutes. So does everyone have a chance to have a look at the minutes? They do now, so do you know, I found it a bit odd because I did look at the first set of draft minutes, as I'm sure you did, and I didn't have a look at them today. These are the like people, not this one. So I said, well, I can't understand why they were wrong because it's all on camera as well. So we should be able to go back into the camera and say, well, that's what we said, that's what we didn't say. Well, I'm delighted to see that the minutes are now an accurate record, and as you proposed, Major, is that agreed by everybody? Okay, whoops, Daisy. Should I sign those so people are content? Okay, lovely. Thank you very much for that. Just want to make a bit of a, before we go into the audit reviews and so on and so forth, a couple of things I wanted to clarify. First of which is, just to let everybody know that, because of one thing or another, you know, with personal circumstances and training and what have you, this agenda ended up being put together kind of without my input. So I think that's going to change going forward. I was also quite keen to find out who is the accountable officer for this committee. So, all the other committees seem to have a corporate director and all that sort of stuff. So I was quite interested to see who are accountable or who is the officer. If I'm unhappy with something, or if any members of the committee are unhappy with, that they should be able to go to. And I think we agreed that we share that it's you. So.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I clarified that from the Director of Governance and Insurance this afternoon. It is me.
Right. Okay. So that's quite handy. So, in fact, I'm also delighted to take part in the issue. Can we ask that maybe committee services or whoever it is that's responsible, we have a process in place and that gets kind of ginger. I mean, we don't have our meetings all that frequent, although, actually. But that would be probably more than survey, wasn't it, for that committee?
I think it would be. So, you, Chair, I think it would be more.
Yeah. So, we all talking quite a while ago, and now our next meeting, for Parliament, isn't until September. You know, time drags on, doesn't it? The council has this habit of, I think I had to move something to the council the other day, and I suggest something. We have a kind of actions list that we can track to see if anything's been done. Sorry, Phil, you wanted to say something?
Precisely that point you made at council, Chair. Perhaps on very old fashioned what we used to have in the days of printed minutes, the big references from committees turned up as a minute from a committee were placed before it, and possibly the new electronic world means that that system is built in. Pondering on things like the annual governance statement, do you think that something like the Thornton Manor case ought to appear in the annual governance statement when it's produced? I'm not a member of the planning committee in recent years, but I was a member of the planning committee the night that the original application was considered a decade ago. And I recall it well because that committee had an interesting debate about it and now we vote on the project.
So, I think I'm asking, can that kind of be gingered up? And when it was, it's the other thing we did talk about. You mentioned the annual governance thing. I need to speak to you about that, Adrian, because it was passed to me saying you need to write a few words about this, and I wasn't chair of the committee. So, and you were. So, speaking on behalf of the committee, I think you probably need to have a word with you about the words around that. But, we should have had at this meeting, as I understand this, we should have had the annual accounts, because we have a legal requirement to publish the annual accounts on the 31st of July, don't we? And we haven't got them. Have you got something you want to say about that, Chair?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. You're quite right. We have a legal obligation to publish our accounts, our final accounts on the 31st of July, on the website, after they have been audited by external auditor Grant Thornton. Now, in liaison with Robin
assuming that one's actually quite important, isn't it? Because that will determine the support, the revenue budget is, which in turn will determine what the council tax level will be, which in turn will also impact on what the level of services should be. So that's, I know, unless you're an accountant, it needs to be quite a choice. But something like that is quite significant, I think.
Yeah, absolutely, Chair. That's why we have to get that completely right. We have to make sure the level of service is not as long as we need to.
So that's something not only Grant Thornton will be interested in, something I'm presuming this committee will be interested in too.
Yeah.
Why we've done what we've done and what the implication of that is.
Yes, so the treatment of it is in line with the Treasury Management Strategy, which is agreed upon council every year. So we haven't played much of that in the Treasury Management Strategy, but we're quite welcome to have a look at what's included in the strategy.
Well, I mean, every time I can remember this, because we got into this with the how much money was being given to for the authority to be used. Oh, we can have a look at the Treasury Management Strategy, which is the yoke there, isn't it?
It is.
So, you know, so unless we, someone has gone through it with a proverbial fine-tuned curve, sometimes some of these things will pop out of it. So, at least then we can have a look at what the impact of that has been, and then you can refer us back to the Treasury Management and why we have a Treasury Management policy that our external auditors have got a concern with. That would be interesting.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
just picking up on a couple more items in terms of the accounts as well. So, in June, there was the government had taken a case at the High Court, which is related to age discrimination on judges and firefighter pensions. They've been defending a High Court case.
Judges' pensions.
Judges. So it's known as the McLeod case. It's the McLeod case, one of the people who actually brought about this case. What it means is, in terms of age discrimination, certain public sector bodies and firefighters and judges were protected. So in terms of their age, and when the accounts call them a bit more briefly than times. And the fact that the government have lost the case and they've appealed the case and that was rejected, the appeal was rejected by the Supreme Court. They weren't party to this probably until about 2 weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago. As a result of this, we've had to have all our pensions re-evaluated. So we've had to ask the Minister for their pension fund and the actuaries to do a full re-evaluation pension statement. This isn't specific to Wirral Council, this is across the whole of the UK, refers to all public sector bodies. So everyone's had to go back and have all their pension statements re-evaluated. We've only just received that back. So as a result of that, we put the changes through the accounts, because it has changed our pension liability within our accounts.
Increased it, yes.
And as a result of changing that, so the pensions note in the accounts does impact on probably quite a few other notes, there are at least 10 other notes. We have to make all these changes, all through the accounts, making sure that they're all right. And then we have to give that to Grant Thornton to audit to make sure that they're happy with the accounts and treat it to that. And they're still actually undertaking all those specific checks and notes in our accounts at the moment.
So just so I'm clear, some relationships, so this one for the McLeod, that's going to change the requirement that we as a council have to put in for pensions. But we would normally see that, wouldn't we, when we get to see the quarterly budget launching, which we do. I think we are a quarter in there, won't we? Well, again, there's no quarterly budgets to be monitored. Shouldn't happen again next year then, is that right?
Yes, Chair.
Yes, I agree.
Could I just raise a couple more points in terms of the reasons for the closure of account? So I'm going to run through the majority of things.
So just so I'm clear, just to keep up for me. So there's issues on our side about us not doing what we need to do. There's issues on them, whoever they are now, it used to be Grant Thornton, on their side. They still are Grant Thornton, so there's issues on their side in terms of their resources being spread. And there's some changes of policy. I would probably have felt a lot warmer inside if it was the responsibility of other people, because we know we've got to do this every year.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. And I think, unfortunately, within the finance team, I have had a senior officer who would normally be responsible for the closure of accounts as well. He's back now, but that's a very experienced officer, so unfortunately, we have felt a little bit of capacity issues there, which is exactly why we've put the additional capacity in following the restructure. So that hopefully will mitigate that for the future as well. Just in terms of a couple of the other things as well, where the accounts have not been audited, we have received an objection on the accounts and some questions for the Cllr audit on the accounts, and they can't send the accounts off until they've been resolved. And there is also the impact on the outcome of the offset inspection, which we will know about on the 29th of July. So we will be able to feed in the results of the offset inspection into the accounts, because that impacts on our value for money judgment, which in previous years has been we've had a judgment which is qualified except for. So in chatting to Grant Thornton, we've all sort of agreed that we wait for the outcome of that judgment so we can really truly and more accurately represent it once that judgment is there.
I mean, the only and the sort of thing I'm hearing is that that's going to be better than it was. Still not perfect, but better than it was. The only thing I would say is I'm hearing this from this probably the first time, which again is somewhat disappointing. Has anyone got anything else they want to say? Some reassurance around the resources. Apparently, it's somebody else's job in the finance department to close the accounts. You've made the point, haven't you, Phil? Are you satisfied with the response that you've had around this?
Well, I refer when the leaders chair wasn't present, we had a general discussion about trying to, for all parties' sake, given the what's described as the hole in the budget, or 22 million, or whatever the figure might be, that we all need to be kept up to date with the latest information. Because, Chair, you might remember, many years ago, there was always a problem in the weeks around about 3 weeks before Christmas where savings were produced by officers. We went through lists.
Yes.
Sometimes so sensitively that members sat with their lists and passed them in, having examined them, because they were difficult to talk about. I don't want our work to be in that same sort of situation again. So we need openness about where we're up to, openness about what can and can't be done in timescales. One of the issues was, and I think Cheryl will help you here, there's a degree of additional delegation to officers now to identify whether there are issues that would need additional consultation, so that if consultation is envisaged, then there's a process to try and get all of those at an earlier stage rather than come to some sort of on the route to sort of the budget out.
Well, if there is this rule set up by a previous cabinet, and I know Matt has said he's far more open and transparent on that, that nothing can go to a committee unless the cabinet has seen it first. Perhaps as a kind of faction on me, perhaps, I don't know, it's too difficult. I'll speak to Pat to see if that still applies, or I can speak to Ian, it can be raised in the leaders group. Okay, yes, yeah, sorry. Yeah, another, yeah,
thank
keep going.
Thank you, Chair. Just to respond to Councillor Gilchrist, the outcome of that meeting has been fed back to me. I happen to come and discuss the budget and the budget monitoring in the year and future years of group leaders, so I have all I'm happy to do that.
Well, all I'm interested in is as well as group leaders, and that's great. But if That's my point. I think, you know, if we're going to be more open and transparent, we're going to talk about the budget, how it's going, the services that are being delivered or not, then I'm going to do it in a public arena. And it's this committee has a role in that. Sorry, Kate, you wanted to say something?
Just to round up really, so what we actually need now from the offices is a timescale for the information that we're lacking. And when we're going to do that, because she points out the meetings are not as frequent, so does that mean that we need another meeting to put all this together so we can actually find it?
No, I think that's a good point, Kate. I'm, as Cher knows, I'm always happy to have, if there's issues that need discussing, I think this I will wait 3 or 4 months till another meeting and then hopefully it will go away. Or the issue will have passed or whatever. So I'm always keen that there are these sort of issues that we should hold additional meetings. I think that's a really good challenge if we could ask, not right now, tonight, but we could ask the officers to go away and make sure that we do fit in that timescale. And could I just say, I still think 6 weeks to produce an end of quarter report, monitoring report, given the importance of it, is bonkers. How can we keep control of the budget? All the information we get is 6 weeks out of date. So I will tell Stuart.
Thank you, Chair. Question, Chair, is it still the case that the Scrutiny Committee is getting their specific monitoring report?
So in the constitution it's the role of cabinet to manage and monitor the budget line.
application. So if I can be reminded what the letter of representation is, I think we got a key role. The things we were asked to do last year, we ought to be being asked to do this year in the proper manner.
Thank you, Chair. If I could just respond to that. So last year, our accounts were finalised before the committee. They were audited, and Grant Thornton have produced their annual report and audit findings after before the committee. That's not happened this year because of all the reasons that I mentioned to you earlier on. So before the 31st of July this year, myself, the chair of the committee, are unable to sign the accounts off because they've not been audited, or sign the audited accounts off. We're not able to produce the letter of representation because we produce that after Grant Thornton produced their report. The letter of representation is a statement from us to say that we've complied with all the relevant legislation, policies and procedures, and there's no, as far as we're aware,